Swayam Prabha, Digital India, Educated India.
This is the syllabus. You already have this one. So we will start from the beginning. It says that we have discussion of strengths of organic acids and bases, and then slowly we will go into various kinetic and thermodynamic aspect, electrophilic and nucleophilic substitution, then nucleophilic attack on aromatic species, followed by nucleophilic addition to C double bond C, and then a lot of these chemistries will come like oxidation, hydroboration, hydroxylation, and towards the end elimination reactions. Okay, so some of the things you have already learned in your previous classes, for example this acids and bases, so those things we will touch in such a way that it will rejuvenate your previous knowledge of it, and we will go a little bit deeper into it. And so in the syllabus they have also suggested two books. One is from Peter Sykes and another is the Finnell. You can follow Peter Sykes, you will get some of the concepts that will be cleared, and you will find some of the examples. But I have followed many other books and collected many examples that will help you to approach different problems. Okay, so yeah, let's start then. Acids and base. So let me ask you, what is acid? Do anybody can answer? This is very simple question, but it has little bit depth in it. So that is why I am asking. So you can write in chat box or you can unmute yourself and you can speak.
Sir, so there are a lot of theories which describe acids and bases. So according to which theory should I answer?
Give a simple one, like Arrhenius theory.
Yes, so Aditya is saying that acids are those which releases H plus ion in solution. Yes. So this is also one answer of that. Okay. Yes, correct. So let us go a little bit in deeper. So the first thing came is like Arrhenius theory, which says yes, Isita, you are also right. Acids are electron acceptors. We are coming. So acids are compounds that yield hydrogen ions, while bases yield hydroxide ions in aqueous solution. This is very important. So this is in aqueous solution. So when you put that component, that compound into water, then it releases H plus or OH minus. But there may be few compounds which does not have a OH minus or which is not at all associated with water. What do you do then? Okay, so that is why later on Bronsted and Lowry, two different scientists, came up almost in the same time, 1923, that acids are substances that would give up proton, that is, these are the proton donors, and base is a substance having a tendency to add proton, that is, these are proton acceptors. So in their theory is basically there are two components involved. One is an H plus donor, proton donor, and another is a proton acceptor. And when they interact, then they lead to conjugate acid and conjugate base. Okay, so you have, let's say, an acid H2SO4 and you have water. So this can act as a base, this can act as acid. It gives up the proton, it forms the H3O+, and it forms HSO4-. So these are conjugate acid and conjugate base. But then later on, Lewis came with a different opinion, because now all the compound may not also have H+ protons, correct? There are some other type of mechanism that could go around. Then what will happen to them? That is why Lewis proposed that acids are molecules or ions which can donate electron pairs. Which can accept electron pairs, and bases are molecules or ions which can accept, which can donate electron pairs. So acids are electron pairs acceptors and bases are electron pair donors. For example, in this example, trithylamine and boron trifluoride. Trimethylamine has this nitrogen has lone pair of electrons, okay? And boron trifluoride has in boron center, it is electron deficient in nature in the p orbital. So this nitrogen lone pair can be donated to the boron center, and that is how this complex could form. So these are also acid base. Here trimethylamine is a base, boron trifluoride as an acid. Okay, there are several other examples also. There are some other examples also possible, like aluminium chloride, titanium 4 chloride, zinc chloride, ferric chloride, etc. These are also acts as Lewis acid. Okay, but when let's say we have been given few compounds, okay, now how can we determine or how can we compare their acidity? So in that case, we would need a parameter, right? So that based on that parameter, we can say that, okay, this acid is better than the other one, or this acid is stronger than the other one, or weaker than the other one. So to do that, this sort of equations are required. So let's say you take an acid HA and you take, let's say, water. So after the reaction, this HA would give up a proton if this is an acid. So you form this H3O plus and A minus. This is the conjugate base of the acid HA. We have already said about this one. Okay. Okay, so my camera is not on. Okay. So, yeah, then how do you express the equilibrium constant? The equilibrium constant can be expressed as Ka, concentration of H3O plus, concentration of A minus by concentration of HA. Here concentration of water does not come because water is present in such a large excess that its concentration does not change. That is why this concentration term does not appear here. Okay, but now this Ka, what is its value generally? Sometimes, like, let's say 1 into 10 to the power minus 5 or 10 to the power minus 6 or something. So writing this Ka every time would be very difficult. So that is why, to make it very simple, this Ka is often converted into pKa. What is pKa? pKa is minus of log Ka. Why the minus? Because if it is minus 10 to the power minus 5, that minus and this minus will cancel out and pKa will be a positive number. Okay, so you do not have to write always a minus in front of it. So that is how you end up getting a pKa. And this pKa is a quantity, is a parameter which will give you an idea how that molecule or compound or species is stronger or weaker than the other one. It is a scale, okay? So that means if the acid is very strong, then what happens? This bond breaking tendency will be very high, correct? So this, then your concentration of H3O plus and A minus will be very high. So because they would like to be dissociated. So your this upper term will be very high. So Ka will be high if it is a strong acid. So stronger acid, higher Ka value. Higher the Ka value because of the negative side, pKa will be lower, correct? So it is a lower pKa value. We can do the same math for the base also. You take a base and water. So when it is an acid, water acts as a base. When it is a base, water acts as an acid. So it gives the proton, it forms BH plus. So this is your, this is the conjugate base of an acid. This is the conjugate acid of a base, okay? Plus you form OH minus. Again, you get the equilibrium constant Kb. This is the term. Then pKb is minus of log Kb. Okay. In this case, also stronger the base, higher is the pKb value, and higher is the Kb value, and lower is the pKb value. Correct? But now, if I give let's say a compound which falls into the kind of a borderline between an acid and a base, and it can depend on the situation. For example, water. In one case it is acting as acid, another case it is acting as a base. So it is a borderline. So you need to know their value. But if you have two values, like one is pKa, another is pKb, then you have two different scales. It would be difficult to compare because these two are two different values. So to bring them into one scale, what one can do is to consider this conjugate acid of the base as the starting one. So basically you just rotate the equilibrium, this base. So you take the conjugate acid of the base in water, and then you get the base and H2O plus. Here, then you have Ka, because this is the acid you have taken, and then this is your term, this is your equilibrium constant. Again, your pKa is equal to minus of log K. In this case, again, when it is a stronger base, if this B is stronger, then it would like to be towards the left hand side, right? Correct. So then your concentration of B will be small and H2O plus will be small. So your Ka will be small. So when it is a stronger base, you have a lower pKa value and lower Ka value. The Ka will be lower because your BH plus concentration will be higher. Correct? So then your pKa will be higher. Got it? Understood, everybody? Okay, if this is understood, now we will go back to the different examples. Okay, so it depends on the strength. So basically, we will be comparing the strengths of acids and bases. The strength of acid and base depends on many different factors, like let's say your geometrical isomer, your electron withdrawing or donating ability. I mean the mesomeric or resonance or inductive effect, then your solvent effect, okay, hydrogen bonding ability, electron withdrawing groups, molecular arrangement, electronegativity of an atom, many things. So rather than discussing them in general, we will focus on particular examples and then we'll put up the point that this is the reason because of which this acid becoming stronger. But in all the parameters that I just mentioned, one thing is common, and you got to remember this one. This is a golden rule. Okay, what is that golden rule? When you want to compare the strength of an acid, you need to remember the stability of the conjugate base. What did I say? When, let's say I have given a question, you have already, I think, answered this sort of question, that there will be four compounds and you are asked which one is stronger acid. Then immediately when you see that sort of question, your mind will immediately go into the point that I have to judge in which case the conjugate base is most stable. Got it? This is a golden principle. If you remember this one principle, you will not be getting lost. When this question comes, your mind will be focused and you can answer them very easily. Okay, so what did I say? Once again, when you are considering strength of acids, you will see immediately the stability of conjugate base. As simple as that. Correct? Okay, so now I give you one example. Let's say I have phenol and acetic acid. So now the question begins. It is the fun part. I am sure many of you know the answer. So you can write in the chat window, or you can, I think chat window is the best one. So which one is stronger in your opinion? Okay. Aditi says acetic acid. Okay.
Acetic acid.
Okay. So why is that so? Why not phenol?
So because in acetic acid, the conjugate base is identical. And also the partial double bond is equally distributed over the over both the compounds made after like removing H plus ion. But in phenol, the length of partial double bond is not equally distributed in the whole structure.
after the removal of H plus ion, and all the structures which made after resonance is not identical. So stability of acetic acid is more than acetic acid conjugate base.
Yes, correct. So the first point, as Aditi said, is the conjugate base of this acetic acid is more stable because it has two resonating structure. After you remove that proton, you get the negative charge. These two conjugate base of this acid are identical in nature. And in this case also, your negative charge is on the oxygen center. Okay? Because of that, these two are more stable. But when it is in phenol, only in one resonating structure, you have this negative charge on oxygen atom. But other case, the negative charge is in your ring, in the carbon center. And also these are not identical in nature. Okay. So that is the correct answer. Okay. I think all of you have given the correct answer except Giridhar. I think now you got the point. Okay. Okay, so then let's go to the second example. Okay. A carboxylic acid and a sulfonic acid. Which one is more acidic?
Sulfonic acid, sir.
Sulfonic acid. And why is that so? Do you have the reason for it? Yes. Aniket is saying sulfonic acid has more resonating structures. Yes, this is the correct answer. Okay. So in this case, if you remove this hydrogen, then you have negative charge in oxygen. This negative charge can come here. Again, it will form negative charge here. It can come, this will form. So it has three resonating structures. So this sulfonic group is more stable, electron withdrawing. So it is more stable than the carboxylic acid. Okay, so this is what is the answer. Sulfonic SO2 group has greater electron withdrawing ability than the CO. Okay, let's go to the third example. this one. This is little bit different. So, okay, I'll answer it. But let's get your thoughts. Okay, any.
Sir, silicon one.
Silicon one. Okay. So
because after removal of from the carbon, there will be O minus attached to the carbon, and here there will be O minus attached to the silicon.
Yeah.
Where in case of silicon, there is vacant 3 orbital, so stability is more in conjugate base.
Yes. So that is the correct answer. So there will be many examples where you will be seeing the stability of the conjugate base through different ways, as I mentioned earlier. So orbital matching and ability to hold that negative charge is a crucial factor. Okay. So the vacant d orbital, or in some cases vacant p orbital, makes a lot of impact on stabilizing the negative charge that it forms after removal of the proton. So in this case, silicon has a vacant d orbital, as Aniket's Ashish says. So in this case, this negative charge p pi d pi conjugation would be possible. So this silicon can accommodate this negative charge through a back bonding. Okay, and that is why it is more stable. But in this case, carbon do not have vacant d orbital, rather it has plus I effect. So this is not at all stable, but this becomes a highly strong base, actually. Okay, so that is why this is definitely a stronger acid. Okay, this example, this is CHF3 and then chloroform. This is basically haloforms, okay, bromoform and iodoform. This is a little bit tricky, okay, but let's see if you can answer.
Sir, J.K. time kiya hua hai ye sab.
Haan.
Sir, J.K. time kiya hua hai ye sab. हाँ during heat preparation we used to remember all this.
Yeah, I know that. So tell me, बोलो क्या होता है?
CHCl3 greater than CHBr3 greater than CHI3 last में CHF3 because वैसे stability 2p3d stability back bonding more stable than 2p4d 2p5d and there is no back bonding in CHF3 so it is the least stable.
Yes, correct. This is the perfect answer. Yes, very good. So yeah, as I said, so first you make you form this negative charge. Okay, I mean if you remove this proton, in all the cases you form this negative charge, and then it gives the back bonding. And as Ashish says, so then your back bonding strength would be much better in this case because your orbital size matching is important in this. Okay, so 2p3d overlap is much stronger than 2p4d overlap, and then 2p5d overlap. But in case of fluorine, it has strong electron withdrawing ability through minus I effect, but as you all know, that resonance effect is much stronger than the inductive effect. So in this case, p pi d pi is not possible, okay, because it do not have any vacant d orbital. So this is the correct order in this case, okay? Chloroform, bromoform, iodoform, and then at last it comes a fluoroform. Okay, this one is also very easy, but maybe a little bit tricky. So yeah, any answer? So this is acetonitrile, nitromethane, and acetaldehyde. So your definitely your first thought would be to see what is the the stability of your conjugate.
Sir, acetonitrile, then cyanide, and then
CH3CH2. Acetonitrile, or which one?
Sir, first is like CH3NO2, then CH3CN, and CH3CH2.
Okay. So this is completely different. In this case, you are in a 6C. I told in the beginning that you have to see the electron, in some cases, you have to see the electron withdrawing ability of different groups. Okay?
Yes.
So based on that electron withdrawing ability, actually, the activity is considered. So here we see the nitro group, of course, nitro group is the strongest among all three. But compared to CN and CHO, actually, in this case, your CHO is a bit stronger electron withdrawing than your CN. Okay, that is why in this case your CH3NO2 is the strongest one, followed by CH3CHO and then CH3CN. Okay, this one is very interesting, and I think some of you have also done this one. So we have mentioned it 1, 2, and 3. So you can just tell me the numbers.
Excuse me, sir.
Yeah, tell me.
Sir, could you please repeat the reason for the last one?
Yeah. So last one, as I said, it depends on the electron withdrawing ability of the groups that is present. Based on that, the stability of the conjugate base will depend. The electron withdrawing ability will depend, will stabilize the conjugate base. Simple. So electron withdrawing ability of nitro is the highest, then comes the aldehyde, and then comes the CH3CN. Okay, and that is why in this case your CH3NO2 is the strongest one, then acetaldehyde, then acetonitrile. Okay, now this example. This example, I think many of you have done. This is a very interesting example. 3 greater than 1 greater than 2. Okay. Any other answer? Okay, anyway, I think Aditi has said already the correct answer. Of the one, and I am sure you know about it. Okay. So why is it three is more? Because in this case, again, you will be seeing the stability of the conjugate base. It is not divagma. It is not just ortho effect, but it is just. If you are talking about intermolecular hydrogen bonding, then that is the correct answer. So, in different parameters, among different parameters, intermolecular hydrogen bonding and molecular geometry plays a very big role in determining the acidic strength in organic molecules. Okay. So, in this case, in this particular case, in aromatic system also, I mean, I'll just take some other points and then come to this one. When it comes to aromatic systems, actually there are many different parameters that starts to play. One parameter is your geometry, whether it is in cis positions, trans position, or I mean, oriented in the same direction or different direction. Then it comes your ring size, whether it can form intramolecular six-member hydrogen bonding, because six-member hydrogen bonding is more stable than any other members. Then it comes which position, whether it is ortho or meta or para, and how they are interacting with each other electronically. That also makes sense. Then comes your electron donating or electron withdrawing effect. That also makes sense. Then actually the strength of electron withdrawing or strength of electron donating, that also may participate, take part. Okay. So all these things matters. We will take maybe another one or two example of that. So in this case, if you take molecule one, if you remove this hydrogen, then you make the negative charge. This negative charge can form hydrogen bonding with this OH hydrogen to form six-member intramolecular hydrogen bonding. And that is how it is stabilized. This stabilization even more in case of compound 3. Okay. So in this case, you have two OH group in the ortho position. So you have possibility of hydrogen bonding in both the sides. That is why it is even more stable. But in case of compound 2, it cannot form intramolecular hydrogen bonding. It can perhaps form intermolecular hydrogen bonding. But as you know, intramolecular hydrogen bonding is more stable than intermolecular hydrogen bonding. Okay, so that is why this three becomes most stable than one and then two. So is everybody understanding, or if anyone has difficulty in understanding, you can feel free and ask questions. Okay, I will answer as many times it is required, not a problem at all. Or you can also come back later. Later on, if you did not understand something, you can definitely ask me in an email or something. I will definitely try to explain it if you have not understood something. Okay. Okay, good. Then let's go to this example. This is basically a very simple example. So first, any answer?
Sir, it is in the right order: A greater than B greater than C greater than D greater than A.
Yes. So in this case, actually, what you need to look at is electron withdrawing ability. Okay, electron withdrawing ability of the attached substituents. So you have the entire halogen series. So fluorine, of course, is most electronegative, so its electron withdrawing ability is very high compared to chlorine, bromine, and iodine. But in this case, in case of CH3, it do not have any minus I effect or minus R effect, but it has plus I effect. So it is actually making it worse. So the pKa values, if you look at it, so the pKa values lower means it is highly acidic. So the pKa values actually gradually increases when you go down the series. Okay, but in this case, acetic acid, the pKa is 4.76, which is a bit higher than that. Okay. Now this effect becomes little bit different when it comes to this kind of two carboxylic acid together. okay, diacids or biacids. Okay, so now can you guess what is the acidity order in this case? Okay, this is little bit tricky. Whenever it comes as a
it is D A B C.
B. This is B A.
Last. D A. Yes, sir.
So you are saying this is the most acidic.
Because both of the carboxylic acid groups are attached with a methyl group, so basically there is no direct contact of CH2 carboxylic group with another carboxylic group. So deactivating group is not like directly attached with the main carboxylic acid group. So, and in the last D option, there is 2 H plus ion can be donated. And then in the first, there is like directly H plus ion will be like it is more stable base. And then in third is weak acid, because in spite of donating 2 H plus ion, if we remove 1 H plus, then the other carboxylic acid group will deactivate the whole base, whole structure.
Okay, so our rule is first, the first rule and the only rule that we said is to judge the stability of the conjugate base. Now, when you judge the stability of the conjugate base, what is the stabilizing effect in this particular example that you need to check? Okay. Now, the stabilizing agent effect for first one, okay, there is almost none. Okay, there is no stabilizing effect in this case. In case of acetic acid, is there any stabilizing effect? No, there is a destabilizing effect, because CH3 has a plus I effect. Correct. Let's consider these two. Now, from this and this, which one has a better stabilizing agent? In this case, your stabilization is cut off electronically, because of this CH2 group, it doesn't allow direct conjugation. But in this case, if you remove this proton COO minus, COOH is an electron withdrawing group, but COO minus is a slightly electron donating group. So if you make COO minus here, this COOH can still withdraw the electron, because in COOH, this carbon is still electropositive, because these two oxygens has electronegative. So Ashish has given the right answer. It is actually C, which comes first. So this is what I wanted to also mention. When you see diacids generally have a lower pKa values. Okay, it has many other factors. I will give another example where geometrical isomer plays a role, where intramolecular hydrogen bonding also plays a role. Okay, so in this example, if you see, actually, this one becomes the lowest, the strongest acid. It has the lowest pKa, because once you remove this proton, this O negative will be stabilized because of the electron withdrawing ability of CO2H. This factor is actually not present in any of the other cases. Okay. Then actually comes to this one, because in this case, let's say you remove one proton. This CO2H has a little bit of, let's say, electron withdrawing ability that goes through one bond away. So at least it is facing a little bit of electron withdrawing ability, withdrawing nature. That is why it becomes a little bit stronger than the other. Then comes this one, because it do not have any destabilizing factor. Okay, that is why it becomes the third one. But in this case, it do not have any stabilizing factor, but it has a destabilizing factor because of the plus I effect of the CH3 group. Correct? Okay. Yeah, this is that example that I want to take. So maleic acid versus fumaric acid. This is a very, very interesting question, and it comes most of the time in many exams. I think some of you have also faced it. So it is cis-butene dioic acid and trans
butene dioic acid.